So, Scott, thank you for joining us for this technology conference. It's wonderful to have Atlassian represented here, given the amazing business you've built in the space. Now, if I can kick off with going back to 2001 when you and Mike started Atlassian, the startup scene here in Australia was far less developed back then and it's changed a lot. So can you tell us a little bit first about your view on the global tech industry now versus where it was back then? And is it easier or is it harder to get a startup out of the gates now?
It's totally easy to get a startup out of the gates in Australia and worldwide.
You're just saying that because you've done it already.
But when we started, I think there's three things you need to get a great technology industry going. You need capital, you need talent, and you need access to markets. And when we started, there was really none of those in Australia. You couldn't sell overseas. There was no local talent and there was no local venture capital. So what's changed over the last 20 years? We've perfected the art of selling online. So that's, no matter where you are in the world, whether you're in Mumbai or Melbourne, like you can sell online. The venture capital industry has changed a lot in Australia. It used to be that there was almost an arbitrage opportunity for, looking at Australian companies. These days, that is increasingly competitive, although I'd still say there's an opportunity to find diamonds in the rough in Australia. And lastly, the talent side of things. I wouldn't say it's as developed as, much larger areas like Silicon Valley. The talent has come a long way and we've imported a lot of talent, people from around the world that want to come work in Australia and work in technology. And so I'd say that model, that those three things have come a long way than it did previously. So I'm very bullish about Australia building out a technology industry.
Yeah, and I know you're a big supporter of that, but, you are right. Things are evolving constantly, but especially in your sector, it's a really fast-paced changing sector. And in that sort of environment, longevity is certainly more challenging, I imagine, than in old industries like ours. Now, in terms of one of the recent evolutions, in 2019, you announced that the future of your products was going to be on the cloud. So how much of a change in strategy was that for you in terms of pivots that go on, given you started life with products that were intended to run on client servers? And so how did you go about, identifying these upcoming challenges and, in fact, opportunities in a disciplined way and responding?
If I think about the 20-year evolution, there's always some change or something new happening. And so for me, it's not necessarily about what's happening right now. It's about how do you position yourself well for change. And Mike and I have been sort of studies and students of the technology industry since we started. It started off reading books about Jack Welch and Lou Gerstner and IBM and GE. And these days you're reading books, about Steve Jobs and, other tech luminaries. And so we've been students of the technology industry for a very, very long time to understand the environment we operate in. Similarly, we think about, Jeff Bezos talks about, instead of focusing on the things that are new and exciting, you as a company should focus on the things that don't change. And if you think about what we do, which is to unleash the potential of every team, collaboration problems, that's not going to change. That's not something that's going to be solved over the next 10 or 20 years. It's just something we're going to get better at over a long period of time. And if you think about collaboration, getting things out of people's heads, coordinating work across across your organization, that's something that we've been investing in for 20 years. And so when we think about sort of the changes, moving to cloud, which is a big, change we've got at the moment, that really is just one of, hundreds of changes that we've had to navigate over the last 20 years. And I think we're in a good spot for that.
Right. That's interesting. So you're saying basically focus on a core, customer need and then respond in the moment, but medium term. But frankly, though, in a sector like yours, there's curveballs happening all the time. The barriers to entry are not as huge. So how do you, stay resilient through that? And you've had bumps in the road. I don't know if you want to discuss a few of them where you've had to close down certain things. Others didn't make it quickly enough. And you have to adapt even though you've got that long-term objective and, need your meeting that you're focused on. How do you stay resilient through that? How have you navigated through some of those things?
Well, I think resilience is a sort of an individual thing. It's hard to know who's more or less resilient than someone else. Like, I think I have a high pain threshold, but my wife has had three children and, I think she would argue that she wins on that one. So I always find it difficult to know where you fit on the resilience scale. But when you think about When you're young as a company or as a person, a lot of the mistakes you make are mistakes of commission. They're things you do. You do something wrong and you regret it later. I know as a young guy growing up, you do a lot of stupid things and you regret them later. But as a young company, you do a lot of things that you're like, wow, we really didn't need to have that sort of that own goal. As you get older and as the company matures a lot, it's mistakes of omission. It's things you should have done that you regret, or you should have invested more in, or you should have spent more time on. And some of the biggest mistakes in Atlassian were when we saw an opportunity and we didn't put enough emphasis behind it or enough effort into it or grasp it with both hands. And so one example, a more recent one is a product set, HipChat and Stride, which were both in the chat space. So yes. I think that would be analogous to Slack or Microsoft Teams chat product. And we were a market leader there. We actually predated Slack's product, but we didn't put enough emphasis into and enough investment into those products early enough. Even though they were tripling year on year, they should have been growing 10 times year on year because the market was so large. And, if I bucketed my things that I would go back and whisper in my ear, if I could go back, I would tell myself that to invest more behind, the beliefs that we had rather than sort of be more softly on these new areas.
It's very interesting. So early on, it's sins of commission, later on sins of omission. And I presume in the early stage as well, then where it's sins of commissions that can blow you up, you want them to be little bets that you're taking. And actually it was reminding me when you were talking about Kim going through more pain with having the kids, my dad said when he got married, the thing that the priest said to him is, may your mistakes be little ones. And he said he had three of those being us. And, that's actually a good message that early on you take little bets based on your scale. And then when you get bigger, you've got to be ambitious about pursuing things that can be game changing.
As you get larger as a company and you operate in more competitive markets, you need to, do bigger entries or bigger efforts to be successful there.
And now that you are large, I've heard you guys talk about this co-opetition. It's wonderful to see you and Mike taking on a bigger role across the sector and trying to bring more players through and create, particularly here in Australia, this tech ecosystem where, more entrepreneurs can learn from each other and develop solutions together. And you've even said you've been happy to see ex-employees go off and start their own businesses, and that feels like a win to you. Can you talk a bit about that, about, what you're trying to do and what bigger players or the whole industry can do together to collaborate and build the ecosystem here?
Patriotically, Australia makes about 1 to 2% of global GDP, and it needs to be producing about 1 to 2% of technology innovation. And so whilst it's great to have Atlassian, one Atlassian, we're not really anywhere near producing 1% of Australia's GDP, and we need many, many more technology companies. And so We're proud, Mike and I are really proud to be the trailblazers of how the technology industry has come to be. We were early. We try to benefit Australia well beyond Atlassian. And we would love for us, Atlassian, to be the 10th biggest tech company in Australia, not the largest. That would be an amazing outcome for everyone, not only for, the jobs and the high-paying jobs, but the spill-on benefits for the economy and the intellectual property and the quality of life that we would all benefit from that happening. And so that's really important to us. And Mike and I contribute, obviously, Atlassian contributes, and we have, the things that we do that people can copy. There are, staff after they've done a tour of duty with Atlassian and say they've worked at us for 10 years, they want to change. Those people go on to be senior leaders in other technology companies in Australia. But Mike and I, beyond that, try and help with our own family offices. So we put capital into Australian businesses to try and help them grow. And expertise, we also work very heavily with the senior leaders of most of the startups in Australia. It's any startup of scale would tell you that we've helped them out in some way with some advice or an introduction or, an ex-Atlassian that's helping them out. So we're really proud of that. And ultimately, hopefully our, we're remembered for that more than we are remembered for Atlassian.
Fantastic. That's great to see you playing for that bigger goal. But in terms of bringing these people through, we've talked a bit about what is required today versus 20 years ago when you guys got started. things like attracting talent, attracting capital, regulatory frameworks, all of that. What are some of the things that you think today are more important to keep this ecosystem developing than 20 years ago?
Immigration is a interesting one. I think, you know, still bringing talent here from overseas is important, and that's been difficult through, you know, through COVID. I think government regulation, unfortunately, you know, in most cases, regulation is a bad thing for, you know, upstarts and the community and so forth. And there's been some regulation recently that probably hasn't directly impacted technology businesses in Australia, but from a reputational perspective and sort of telling the technology industry that the government's on board, there's areas that they could improve there. But like, I think we have all the ingredients in Australia. Like, you know, we have the best, you know, some companies on a world stage, right? Canva, you know, are worth $10 billion or more. Atlassian, Safety Culture, CultureAmp, Deputy. Like, there are dozens of companies out there doing this. And so I think Australia, you know, is poised for a kind of a renaissance of technology companies that sell globally. And I don't think there's anything huge holding us back at this stage.
Well, you know, with some of the challenges you've mentioned, it seems like Australia is punching above its weight, because we're in a world where, you know, the big superpowers, both the US and China, have made domestic technological development a priority in their race for their international competitiveness. So we're getting, you know, for their sector dominance, we're getting more of these regional hubs happening. I was curious as to what you think these regional hubs are doing in terms of increasing regional competition for customers, which you've said is a really important thing in driving your business, and for capital across this sector?
Well, we are seeing a sort of an increasing balkanization of the internet, which I don't think is something that the people want. You know, take China, for example. They've sort of got the Great Firewall. We sell a nominal amount of software over in China, but it's unlikely to be, you know, it could be a huge opportunity for us, but they have chosen to go a different way. And so it's not a huge part of our growth, you know, opportunities. And I think if you see at the moment, you've got the Chinese firewall and then the rest of the world is open.
Yeah.
But what we're seeing with increasing regularity is that we have regulation in different areas that is different. So whether it's GDPR in Europe that is different to the California privacy policies or Australian privacy policies that just require companies to be different enough that you end up with, you know, different companies becoming large in different areas. And
yeah,
whilst we want competition, that's fantastic. It doesn't make it makes more sense to have competition globally than it does having, you know, three or four players, you know, vie for the Australian part of the market and three or four different players vie for the European part of the market. You'd be much better off if you had three or four players at scale competing globally. And so that's an area of worry, is just that making sure that governments and other people who have that ability think about the implications of having different legislation in different geographies.
We're almost out of time. So as a last question, what I did want to ask you, given the times we're in, is about COVID and the impacts of COVID. Basically, it has been an opportunity for technology really to come to the fore, and everything we do in our industry, be it, you know, communications infrastructure, renewable infrastructure, people are living, working, you know, every learning from home, it's had a huge impact in terms of the digital transformation taking place within organisations as well, with all this remote working. But I was particularly interested for you how the pandemic has, in your view, altered the direction of the technology industry.
There's a couple of things. Mostly, I think it has changed the speed and not necessarily the direction, as in we've had 12 years of digital transformation in 12 months, and it seems as every month goes on in the pandemic, we get another year's worth of transformation. And that is companies who had a physical presence now had to be multi-channel, you know, food outlets, medical area. You can order food from almost any restaurant these days. You know, whereas previously that was only a few, you know, on the company side, people had to learn how to work from home. People have had to do digital supply chains. On the consumer behavior, which is actually the hardest thing to change because companies have economic incentives to do it, but consumers don't necessarily do that. We've now had learned how to homeschool, how to work from home, how to travel into different locations to buy online. And so the consumer behavior has changed a lot. And I think that's not going back. No matter what companies want to do, the consumer behavior has changed forever. And so when I think about the change in sort of kind of direction in terms of what's different to what it was previously. What we're seeing for Atlassian is more demand for our products because of the asynchronous nature of work when people are working from home. And, you know, it's great to do Zoom and Slack and Teams, but no work ever gets done in a meeting. Work gets done, meetings create work. And if you want to organize work and move it around your organization and operate asynchronously too, because there's one thing to say everyone's going to work from home, it's another one to say everyone's going to work from home and have the flexibility to work in the time zone and the times that they want. And so moving people from synchronous work to asynchronous work, I think is a change that we wouldn't have seen if it wasn't for the pandemic. And that's driving a lot of demand for our products so that people can, you know, work at, someone can get one part of the job done and then hand it off to the next person without it needing to be done at the same time. And so I think that's the biggest change that we've seen.
Interesting. So COVID's had a massive impact in terms of catapulting the response from the technology sector generally. But the other area we've seen it have a huge game changer effect is in health. Do you have thoughts on health and technology coming together and how it's impacted that?
On a personal level, people ask, well, if you weren't doing Atlassian, what would you do? And I think one of the interesting trends at the moment that we are very early on is the bringing together of health and technology, whether that is computer processing power or big data or, you know, physically technology being, you know, implanted or working with you. I've got my little, you know, Oura ring and a Garmin watch that, you know, kind of tracks my statistics, but it goes a lot deeper than that. And if you looked across the things that Australia is uniquely positioned to do, we have a world-class health industry that is relatively centralized. It's not quite the NHS in the UK, but it has a lot of centralized data. So that gives us a great data sets. Unlike the UK and many other places, it's quite a heterogeneous data set, right? We have people of all different races and backgrounds and immigrants from around the world. And that allows us to, you know, test and try out and use data sets that actually are representative worldwide. And if you look at the companies that we produced, whether it's ResMed or Cochlear or CSL or, you know, there's plenty of biotech companies that have come out of Australia. And that's a very technology heavy industry. And we're really at the early stages of that. And I think Australia is well placed, probably the best placed of any nation to take advantage of that bringing together of technology and health. And I'll give this example personally. I invested in a small healthcare startup in Australia that does 3D printing of cells. And previously, if you wanted to test a drug in a petri dish, you would test that drug almost on a 2D, you know, set of cells. But if you think about it, no drug in the body ever hits, you know, 2D cells that have been nicely sliced up on a plate. It meets with cells that are, you know, in a 3D environment. And so this literally prints these cells that you're trying to test, you know, drug treatments on in a 3D environment. And again, when we can do that at scale, you know, imagine, you know, drug testing or, you know, unique drug testing, Shemara, instead of wondering if you have side effects, we can take your cells, grow them in a lab, you know, test 1,000 different drugs on them and try and work out which is the right one for you and do that overnight. Like we'll be in a different stage. And so I think Australia is uniquely positioned to take advantage of that new trend.
Well, it's amazing. I mean, what you guys have built with Atlassian is phenomenal, but we're hearing that Scott Farquhar is really just a frustrated Dr. Atlassian. So watch this for the next big thing. But congratulations on, you know, the incredible job you and Mike and the whole team have done with Atlassian. We're very proud of you. And thank you so much for making a little bit of time for our technology conference.
Thanks so much, Shemara.